Welcome to this session. It's called Who Controls the Data? Controls the Organization. So know your data. My name is Steinar. I work at MI.
I'm Ilja. I have a double life. I'm a freelance fundraising consultant, and I'm a part-time fundraising officer at Amnesty International Flemish section.
Yeah. So. And we have a joint presentation, and we have joint interests, and that's why we are connected in the community. Yeah. What we are going to talk about today is. Pyramid. What's the relationship between the data input, the data analyzing, and how to visualize your data, and hopefully to make decisions based on your data? You could picture yourself or your organization as a human being. Hands, that would be the back-end staff workers, writing data into CV. The heart, that's the fundraiser, communicating the cause of the organization, why do you exist, why do you do this. The feet are the board. Hopefully they take the body in a certain direction. And we have the brain, doing data analytics and trying to understand the organization. And then you have a nerve system, connecting hands and feet and brain. And that's obviously a CiviCRM. Then you have the veins, and that's hopefully the CEO, transporting the course or the fingertip of the organization. And all of this organization, or this person, is actually a man carrying another man. And that person is the program staff. Or actually, what your organization do. In my case, that would be the pilots. We are a back-end organization carrying them. So the point is to reintroduce ourselves. I'm Hans and Brain at MF Norway. And Ilja, he is Hans and Brain. So who are you in your organization? You can have multiple roles, and many people can share the same role. But what is your body part? Anyone wanting to say what they are? Yeah.
I'm heart and brain.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyone else? Yeah.
CEO.
Yeah. Anyone?
I'm a brain. We don't really have a heart.
Yeah, brains without heart, without hearts, that can be difficult. Yeah.
Set it up on a table. You could have internal heart. You can have external heart. This could happen in many ways. And I would say, if you don't have a heart, you are in a risk of dying. Because why do you exist?
Statutory.
Yes. So, internal, external heart, hands, you can have external data input, but that could be costly. And you can have it in-house, but if it's too big, then you have too much people on your table. Feet, hopefully the board is loyal to your organization, but it could be things where the board is not your organization, but they are sort of a collection of boards. Brain, you can have a external brain, someone delivering the analytics for you, for your organization. That could be risky because you don't know exactly what they are thinking. Could also be internal, but if it's only internal, it could also be like you are only focusing on your own. No system, of course, external system. Someone else owns your data, a closed source system, or an internal system where you control your data on your own. Just skip the CEO. Mm-hmm. This was our organization 5 years ago. Internal heart, external hands, internal feet, external brain, external nervous system. Means we had a CRM system controlled by others. We bought it, or they delivered services for us, but it was external. Now it looks like this in our organization. And Ilya's organization looks like that. Yeah.
We do a little bit of everything. We have a lot of stuff both externally and internally. Sometimes they forget to communicate between each other, but that's not a discussion. And I did put myself somewhere in the middle, and it's a funny thing. Sometimes I don't know whether I'm internally at Amnesty or external, but that's that has advantages and disadvantages. The main thing what started to do our work before as a purely external consultant for Amnesty, and then they started to see that it's becoming that much and that kind of central in the world that they thought it would be much better to have it more internally, and so it's splitting over. Anyway, the thing for us, it's quite important for you to think about what is your context, what are you doing internally, what are you doing externally, and what are the risks involved in either doing it externally or doing it internally. And I see too often that organizations don't really think about it. Why do we do what internally or externally? So that's the thing.
Yeah, and the point is, if you are doing analytics about the data, you should know that the ones who delivers the analytics, they actually do a lot of thinking, and the one who controls that actually controls the organization, because you can control what sort of decisions the decisions maker would make based on your analysis.
Hey. Let me tell you a little story of an organization. Of course, not yours organization, I'm aware of that. But it happened at an organization that some people in the organization are sitting together, having a chat and having some great ideas. Yeah, let's do this. We could do that. Or we're doing great stuff. And what happens in those organizations is that the evening goes by, and we are sure that we are doing good things, and we are a great organization, achieving amazing results, whatever you want. The reality is, however, that it tends to be just joking about yourself, a kind of not seriously about what is happening. We just do stuff. Because we do stuff without really thinking about what are we doing, without really thinking what is the impact, what is the reality of it. And that's why I would like to introduce to you to data-driven decision-making. And there was a big difference in between doing something just because you do it and doing something because you did some serious calculations and analytics, whether it works. And for example, the whole thing of split run testing. Who is familiar with A/B testing? Yeah, that's fantastic. Who is doing it on a daily basis? That's the kind of thing. If fundraisers or marketers whatsoever, we do not test enough. Some do it really well, others do it well, and then you have. I had a nice discussion some time ago with Amnesty International in which picture you use in a direct mail piece. There was some prisoner made some drawings about the torture methods that were used on himself, and there was one drawing about the man and there were electroshocks on its testicles. And could we show that or not? The reality is that the communications department is full of women. You cannot do that. You cannot show that. And the men within the organization say, yes, let's show that. The men would immediately understand what's about. So we did a split run, a version without the picture, a version with the picture. And then you see what the difference is. And the end is that we now use that picture. Because it shows much more. But if you do not test it and just discuss between each other, we should use it, we should not use it, you then end up with doing stuff without really knowing what is happening. And the reality is that just what you think about it is often not the case, what is really happening and what works, what does not work.
What do you call it?
A-B testing, split runs. Well, the basic idea is that you do two pieces of communications with a little thing you change, and you test the results, you see what version has more response, and then you choose on which one you allowed based on that. And the thing is that if you do it really systematically in every type of communications you do, step by step, you learn to optimize the whole thing. And it's just, I feel it would work. No, you have some basic facts about how it works.
Yeah, I think now it's about
this one. Yeah.
Doing all this, you have different systems. Ideally, you have just one system for the patient, but in reality, you never have. You have a lot of different systems producing data. And for data analyzing, you could also use a lot of different tools. When we are talking data analyzing, okay, CiviCRM is not the solution. CiviCRM provides the data, but to analyze it thinking with your brain to actually understand your data, then it could be a good thing to have another program checking the same data. So the data input is here, but then the analyzing, and then for the visualization, you could use still other. And for decision. In my organization, they would say, okay, the board takes the decision. They want it ready made. They want to have one slide, one graph, and say, oh, okay, this is good, this is not good. And sort of, they just want the solution. They just want to make the decision. And you have a lot of tools doing that, but you need to communicate and visualize how you do it. And for each of these, it's different things that's important. For data input, it's really important with consistency. You have consistent data. If not, it will be all wrong in the top. Here it's about thinking. Here it's about communicating. And then someone is doing the conclusion. And I call this the one glimpse approach. The decision makers, they want to have one glimpse and then decide.
The whole thing is, before we start playing with data and doing data analytics, we cannot stress enough the importance about fast data entry, quick data entry, and for sure if you're monitoring. I'm for Amnesty International now monitoring a 1 million grow investment fundraising program. And basically, let's be quite honest, the deal with it, if the program fails within 2 years, Amnesty Flanders will be bankrupt. That's the kind of thing. So the board said, you can do it, but you have to be sure to monitor every weekly developments of what is happening. Are you still on track? And if you are not on track, then you should stop the investment program straight away. But if the data in my system and I look whether I'm still on track is 2 months old, I cannot work. I cannot do that. So the real key thing about getting your data into it as fast as possible is a key thing to work with data anyway. And otherwise, you have just some nice historical archive, but you don't have a system where you can work on. And I find out that a lot of people, because it's two different worlds, data entry, kind of day-to-day things is one thing, and the decision-making, the management is a totally separate world, and often we don't see the interaction between it. And after board members or CEOs don't think enough about what is the data, the date of my data. Is it still actual? Is it still up to date? It's really important to have that. Another thing that we see if you work on data analytics is that you have different types of data and you need them all. Usually in a classical CRM system, what you have there is transactional data. Data about who did made what communication, who made what contribution. You have some transactions that happens, and some direct marketeers think they can do profiling based on that and use things like RFM, recency, frequency, monetary value to evaluate the donor. But only transactional data is quite not enough to be quite accurate and have a complete picture. A lot of other things. Additional data, that's my most favorite thing. Surveying, what do people think about your organization and how that influence and how they act. Who of you does regular surveying of donors or members or whatsoever? Only one, two, three, some, okay, yeah. And for who, that is really a part of the whole journey. It's a little bit, that's quite important. And who adapts the communications you send to a certain donor based on what they answer in the surveys? And it's a whole thing, it's quite important to have it. Another thing is activity data, who does what? And it's contextual data, it's environment, and that's what we tend to call big data, data from outside you combine in. And sometimes it's quite important to plan. For example, I run some telemarketing operations. Telemarketing is heavily influenced by the weather. Rainy days, you need to provide more call agents because more people are at home that can call you or you can call. In sunny days, people are out. You don't have that many processes in telemarketing. I see, for example, a big difference in the results of female or male street recruiters depending on the weather. And so it's quite interesting to have the whole picture and see what happens. Some donors recruited in the streets during really rainy days tend to stop quicker than people that not recruited then. So if you know that and you can combine those information, you have a much clearer picture about what is happening, and you can profile segment more directly, and that would influence a more cost-efficient way of working. Another thing that it's indeed, and Steinar reflected already on it, if you want to work with your data really nice, you need to have the infrastructure to do that. The software, everything, software and hardware to work in. And when I started at Amnesty International Flanders, they kind of half year ago started with CiviCRM. It was a kind of big release. Finally, we have a database system. And then I came in and I said, okay, nice, you have a data system. Now I want an analytical server to work really with the data. Oh, another system. Any kind of, people don't expect it, but you need to have those different elements to work together. You have a CRM system keeping track of your daily operations, data going in and managing. You have data analytics to really look inside into that. And then you have some reporting visualization tools. Often you have a bookkeeping system where you keep track of some costs and income happening there. And then you have to be able to communicate with all those systems and send data from one place to another. And it's for you, it's important to find the right mix of software tools. The construction we have in Amnesty is CV, of course, for the daily stuff. We have RapidMiner as a data mining tool for analytics. And we have ClickView, ClickSense for the reporting stuff. And we have Exact as a bookkeeping system. And they kind of all are integrated and exchange data between each other. But you need somehow to set up that structure. And there are different possible tools with each of them having advantages and disadvantages. So you have somehow to find a mix for you to set up. If we talk about data-driven, for me there are two key elements. What data-driven is about. One thing is the level of knowledge you have about what is happening in your database. The other thing is really be able to do some extreme personalizations and communications with to the donor. And the whole thing about data-driven is just the first part where we are talking now here to doing some analytics. But basically you can do the both with the same basis. Okay, so what is data-driven decision-making? Any idea?
Making decisions based on data.
Is it? Okay. There is some process behind it, and that's the whole process about getting from raw data some ones and zeros and strange other codes. You play with it, you have some insights, what is happening, what trends you see, how does this sums up, and you build knowledge on it, and then you make a decision on it, what we do with it. And there is a difference. If I look, for example, in what we call predictive modeling, in my eternal example of street fundraising, at the day after recruitment, I'm for about 70-75% sure who will stay the next 6 months and who will leave. I will not continue automatically. I kind of know that. But then, that's the knowledge. Then comes a strategic decision. What we do with them? There are two options. Or we decide not to communicate at all. Will those even not bother? Or we could decide just to do some additional communications to keep them even more. And that's the decision thing. And there are two separate things with advantages and disadvantages. Some knowledge you have, but you cannot use. And some elements are also legal. If you are in insurance and you use data mining in insurance, you know there is a gender difference in risky behavior between male and female. But legally, you are not allowed to use that, for example, to set your price differences because men are more risky, so they have to pay more for the insurance. You cannot do that on a gender basis. Even though you have the knowledge, you cannot do the decision making based on that. So there's a big difference in both. You can do it on different levels. You can do it on a strategic level, on an operational level, on an individual level. We come back to that in a minute. Anyway, for the whole thing, it's about reaching your organizational goals. And the whole thing is to reflect constantly back to what is your strategic goal. The whole thing, for example, with the strategic fundraising extension that Bjorn showed, you can have a lot of KPIs, but depending on your goal, the relevance KPI is a different one than the other one. And you just have to be aware of what you want to achieve. So what is a relevant KPI? What is a relevant thing to focus on? Some basic things. What often people tend to confuse, if you work in data analytics, there's a big difference in looking at the past and looking at the future. In the jargon, we call looking in the past, we call it BI, business intelligence. while looking in the future, we call predictive analytics, just to make the distinction. Looking in the past is basically about reporting and understanding what happened, why did it happen, and you can learn something from it. Predictive is kind of the big magic about what could happen, what will happen, and how we can act on that. And if you put that in some orders of stuff you can do when you play with data analytics, the most basic thing you can do as an organization is reporting just what happens. So, for example, what CV Reports does, it just reports what happens. Some board members really love it, but basically it's just basic information, what happened, nothing more. A step further, what you can do is explaining why did that happen? What are some correlations? What elements triggered the thing that happened? It gives some more understanding. A little bit further is looking now is having dashboards, is really looking at what is happening now based on data of today and how that means in how we should adapt or how we should move. If you drive a car and you have this dashboard in front of you, the only a few parameters you look, have I still have some fuel? Am I not driving too fast? You have some key elements where you can act on at that moment. If you see you're running out of gas, you find the next gas station. It's a day-to-day what is happening now. It's not really big reports about sums and total amounts erased, for example. It is what is happening now. If I look at straight fundraising, I don't care about the total income. For example, one of my key metrics in straight fundraising is the average age of the donor. Because I know that if they are under 25, the risk of stopping is too high. But I can monitor that from day to day. I can't say on one day to another to my street fundraisers, guys, you are signing up people that are too young. Stop that and focus on the more older people. And I see that this is a kind of predictor for future income. I don't look at the income at the moment of the recruitment. It doesn't tell me anything about what I can do now. Looking in the future, it's a little bit about optimization. So that's the things like A/B testing, what you can do better, how you can adapt stuff. And even more advanced is the whole predicting thing. What might be happening? What I could do to change? And we come in some examples of this. And so you build up knowledge. And that's all the predictive thing. What we basically do in predictive modeling, anybody familiar with predictive modeling? More or less. So what basically do, you take a whole bunch of data and you look what tends to do, what people tend to do, and then you predict what other people could do. For example, what I do with telemarketing is a terribly costly thing, but quite effective. The only thing is, if you waste your money or time calling people that will not respond anyway, you're wasting your money. So with predictive modeling, I try to see which people I will not call, which people I will call, and you can focus more and be more cost effective. And that's what the guys at RapidMiner, they call that predictions. You do a prediction, and based on that, you do an action. Typical examples is deciding in what segment is it? Will the person respond on a direct mail or not? Some trends, what will happen if you continue working like this, in what cluster of people is, and you have what things come together. This last thing is known as association, is recommender modeling, is most famous about what is Amazon doing. So what Amazon does, if you come to their website, they predict what book you probably would like to buy, based on your past behavior, your gender, whatsoever. So they suggest people like you that bought also that book. And then again, you have, if you are some creative, you can find a lot of applications in a nonprofit context. But I'm trying to do it with Amnesty, but people are scared of letting me doing it. You know, in there are hundreds of ways you can support Amnesty. You can do a donation, you can write letters, you can go to a manifestation, you can sign a petition. And what we know in fundraising is that what is called multiple engagements, if people have different ways of engaging with your organization, they tend to stay more loyal and more supporting. The whole thing is some people like to do this, other people like to do that. And if you go to a donor or a supporter whatsoever and you say, okay, you have here a list of 100 possible ways of supporting us, people get crazy and they don't choose one of them. If you can go more exactly, to you I will propose to write a letter, to you I will propose to make a donation, then it might be more effective in the communication thing. The only thing is that people get afraid of it internally in organizing, saying, oh, you are making the decisions instead of that person, you should respect the freedom of that person and give them all the choice. So it's something you have to overcome somehow. The whole thing of data mining, how it works, is you have some raw data and you prepare it, you put it in some right forms, and then you play with algorithms to see what is happening there, and then you get some model scores, clusters, whatsoever, and you interpret that. Be aware that a computer does the most stupid things if you don't have a human being controlling it. I have, for example, and it's quite nice for supporter care, I do something that is called anomaly detection. So overnight I look at strange behavior of donors. Suddenly stopped, suddenly give more changed patterns in behavior, and it gives a signal to a supporter care person to do something with it, to contact that donor to check what it's at. But half of the time an anomaly detection algorithm comes up with some stupid things that really does not matter, but that's that human thing you have to filter out afterwards. Okay.
Yeah. Wikipedia explained data visualization. And you see, it's communication, graphics, reasoning, understanding. It's all about communicating your data. And it all comes down to trust. Do you trust me? Do you trust me? You could stand in front of a board, and if they don't know you, they don't trust you. And if they trust you, you can say whatever and say, ah, this is nice. So, yeah, basically, it's about trust. Because you could have a nice analytics, but if you don't communicate it correctly, it doesn't matter. So, communication, yeah. A good way to make the decisions, like you believe, is to make them believe that they are. I figured this out on my own. And that's really a clever way. Because if they don't trust you, and you say, oh, we should stop doing street recruitment because I have found this, doesn't matter. It's all about making the decisions makers think, ah, this is how to do it. But you can use that with many tools. But again, it's not about the tool, it's about communicating and about about you. Do they trust you? But hard facts, we could, yeah, this is the data. What do you do? You can take different approaches. Here I have presented that. Here as a line. Here as bar graphs. And here as that. Is this positive or negative?
What do you measure?
Think you are a board member now.
Wrong limbs. You don't get one. Is this positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative. What about this then?
Negative.
Yeah.
Negative.
Yeah, but not that, not that negative. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this one though. Mm. Isn't this good? Yeah. It's the same data. It's the same data. I will explain what I did here. Mm-hmm. You see, just
you
the
squeeze
angle,
it down.
Yeah, the angle. And the size of here. You see here for numbers. If I put them on top of each other, then you automatically compare them. But if you do like this, it's not that revealing that in some way. And here it's just year to date. Year to date. So it's just adding a thing. Yes, as I said, this campaign was actually one of the most successful campaigns. But because I did it now, you said, it's negative. But it actually was positive. Mm-hmm. And that that depends on how you are presented. And that's why I say big trust, big responsibility. Because my board would say, he delivered this these numbers. They would just say. So it's that's why it's to only have external data analyzing could be dangerous if you don't know what they were thinking. Because here I just what I explained. You have a negative situation, you want to show it, because sometimes you want to alarm the board and say, this is going bad. Then you have red colors and steep clouds, yeah? And you have the other way, forgive. If you think it's basic, but the people that are making decisions often have little time, and they just, wrong lips. And if you fail on this, if you show positive numbers in red, then it's not positive at all. So, yeah, be aware of it.
Okay, just to give you some inspiration of the kind of strategic questions you are confronted with as a fundraiser and how you can what kind of answers to questions you can find in data if you play a little bit with I just keeping saying playing with data because it's just fun. Some people look strange to me when I say that, but I'm serious about it. Just playing with data, but you can, depending where you are reaching your goals, you can do some budget adjustments. You can make investment decisions based on what works not. You can focus more target groups for acquisition or cultivation programs just by looking about what types of donors we have and where we focus on and where not. Just some other thing about looking at figures. The blue lines here are the new donors in an organization coming in every year again, and it looks positive. And a lot of organizations look at that figure as a KPI, the number of new donors coming in every year. Nice, every year so much new. The red one is the net growth. That's the difference between the new donors coming on and the donors stopping. And then you see they are actually diminishing for sure in those last years. The thing is that the board only looked at the blue one. And they didn't even calculate the other one. So if you don't do it right, you can make some seriously bad decisions. Another example I like to show is the evaluation of telemarketing operations. Somebody of you does telemarketing? The costly thing, and what happens with telemarketing is that a lot of people say no, the phone. I will not start a direct debit or whatsoever. And other people say, yes, I will do. And then if you evaluate it and you look at how many people said yes to at the phone, it might not always be that positive return on investment. And the reason of that is that in evaluations, we tend only to look at the people who say yes at the phone. And we look at, did a person said yes to the phone? Okay, then we calculate as a positive result. The reality is, if you do something like this, and in data analytics, it is called temporary abstraction. It's looking at different, because in the telemarketing, everybody is called at a different date. So giving before and giving after the call is, for every individual, is a different time. So if we look and we see that in a telemarketing operation, you basically have two groups of people after the calling. You have a group of people who say, where you don't have contact with, you didn't reach them, just because you didn't were at home or the phone number wasn't valid or whatsoever. You have people you had a conversation on the phone, but they say no. And you have people who said yes. And if you compare, for example, for a reactivation phone campaign, giving before and giving after, then I had to make some abstraction, but that's the average level. The average giving after a call for the people who said yes to the phone is about 4. And the people who say no to the phone still give more after the phoning. And that is because the phone was a kind of reminder and people had to think about it again. It might be in a direct debit. No, I don't want a direct debit, but I would like to do a one-off gift. Yeah. And then it means that you have to bring back data and again and to analyze again to see what is the real result. A thing is not a thing. I have a lot of fights with telemarketing agencies where anyone getting annoyed with telemarketing agencies calling you and saying, I have a great offer for you, but you have to decide now in the phone. You don't have some time to reflect. I always ask, please send me some documentation on it and I will look at it. And they never do it. The reason why they don't do it is because they are paid on targets and they only look at this. And their clients don't like to kind of communicate back the positive response after a telemarketing operation that you can link back to a telemarketing operation, but because people on their own way they contacted, they put it that way. That's why I have now a bad reputation at Amnesty International. I succeeded to dramatically decrease the number of spontaneous giving. Before I started, we had a big group of people, it was about 200,000 euros a year, spontaneous giving any year again, every year again. And board say, why do we need fundraisers? They give anyway. Till that the basic reason why it is that people answer to a direct mail package, but they don't add the administrative code of the mail package. So it comes in as a spontaneous donation. So it's looking at that. The other thing is a little bit more confusing. Do you sometimes have the feeling that you are doing too much things at the same time? I have colleagues from Donor Voice who developed a kind of way of deciding what you should do. Should you be more on Facebook? Should you be more on Twitter? Or should you focus on a good supporter service? And what it does, it lists a whole things of things you could do to improve your fundraising. You put that into a survey to donors. And what you then do is you correlate what people say about what things you do they think is important. You correlate that with their actual giving. And then you end up with some matrix where you can see that some things you have to scale up or do really good and some things you shouldn't do anymore because it doesn't make sense. And I would like to stress the importance of, if you do surveying, to correlate that back to the actual behavior of people. Any organization have people who love to complain, and we spend endless much time on them. But to be honest, I'm quite, pragmatic, I would say. Others give some more negative words for it. I care more about complaints of people who actually do donate than complaints of people who do not donate. But people who complain, they tend to kind of take over your organization. And if you start to base your decision making on that, you can end up in some wrong decision making. So always correlate what people say about you with what they actually do. Some operational things you could focus on. what recruiter performs well or not. My face-to-face program manager has a dashboard where he looks at individual results of each individual fundraiser. Who performs well, who not. And they don't use that to fire immediately, but to kind of start exchange and training about what is the difference. Yeah. Some other operational stuff.
This is just a visualization of Norway. Just test average gift by content and total gift by content. And just showing that, what could you derive out of that?
The bottom left of the country is more populous. Unless
you
normalized it.
No. Actually, this is the most populous area. So, but correct, as you see. So then you can make some decisions on this. You can have a feedback to the CEO. So, most of your income, total good, comes here. Place your events there. You can say to the analyst, is it is there a pattern? To see here, if they give more here, a higher average gift, but less total amount. And feedback to Fundraiser, if your appeals are more, if you get more money here, maybe you should select a style that suits them better than this. And all this, just by putting it on a map. Here we have some other thing. When you donate on online bank, you can write a message. And here we have this for the campaign. And here we have measured what people have written when they are donating. And then if you look at the words, there are some from campaign-specific words, but also the word gift, that was okay. But I was curious to see help was often written. And then I said, maybe the fundraisers should not always ask for a gift, but ask for help. That's also,
just a question, who of you does register the free text wordings that people tend to add to donations when they do a bank transfer or whatsoever? So people tend to do some free text messages when they send a donation to you. They write it on a check or you put it in a bank transfer, things like, you are doing a great job, I support you. Who does enter that information into the CRM? You should do it.
Yeah, no, I should just say here, I analyzed the people who doesn't write anything, they give in average 690 Norwegian kroner. And if you actually write in the field, you donate twice as much. So actually, writing in the field tells a lot of your commitment to the organization.
Just to add in the same thing about service, donor service, I am passionate about open field text boxes where people can comment and usually put phrases there. Describe in your own words why this organization is important for you or stuff like this. There are two reasons why it's fun for communications people to read wordings that donors use. The other thing is whether you answer or not, You take the effort to put some data in it. It's a great predictor for donor loyalty. So it's kind of things you can use for segmentation. Is people who take the effort to communicate something more, you know that will be they will be more loyal afterwards. The kind of signal they give. Yeah, things like other stuff you can ask your database and play with it and see how you can. Prevent it. We're kind of some minutes left. So for those who are into data mining, this is a decision tree. This is kind of the results what the data analytics process finds out. This is about will a face-to-face donor stay or not, depending on some information we find out in the data. We can decide whether people stay. It results to some technical adaptations. What I did find out is that if you do a welcome call after street fundraising and you cannot reach the person and you leave a message on the voicemail, don't do it. People tend to stop easier if you did that. Take some additional effort to contact your back and to contact back to try to call again. And if you really are not able to reach them, then just don't leave a message, because if you leave a message, they tend to stop easier. It's just, anyway, to be clear, this kind of stuff, if you try to analyze, you find out some things, it doesn't mean that you all have to copy that blind and say that is the saving knowledge whatsoever. You have to test and analyze it again, but it's how what you see in your data and analyzing your data could optimize your performance and the way you work.
Yeah. All about the donors. Not my donor.
Listen to me.
How would you address him? What's his name? Does anyone know?
Bill Gates.
Yeah. That's good. In Civic, I would call him William Henry Gates III, because if he wants tax deduction, then I need his formal name. And if he pays me money, he would use his formal name. But I also use this field for nickname, to call him Bill, because he's Bill.
Yes.
Yeah. So when I'm sending a letter to him, I put this on the letter for the postman, and I write, "Dear Bill." It's a small thing, but checking for NLS on this, if you have the same first name and nickname, you give approximately 500 in average. But if you have different name, that we actually have written another name for nickname and use it, you give 50% more. Excellent. So that's an important feedback back to the hands of the organization, to pick up every time they understand, maybe this person wants to be addressed in a different way, you should record it. And back to the fundraiser, it's important to use the name of people when you are communicating with them.
Just to add a fun thing, who of you does kind of peer-to-peer fundraising, in the sense inviting your donors to do a member, get member action and bring new donors in? Who does it? Huge success. Usually when organizations do it, they say it's betting, don't do it because it's not that successful, donors do not do that. Unless you are able with this kind of things, if you look at the Bill Gates story, this is a small group of donors. You have this first name and nickname, but those small group they have a big average amount. This kind of member get member peer-to-peer fundraising, if you target them to only this one, this group, your response and your success will be much more better than do it just to every donor.
Back to the tools. I started with a one glimpse approach with the board. But ideally, I don't want that. I want my board to actually dig into this and try to figure this out on their own, because it's much better, and they know the data as well. So there are some tools. We are using Tableau. Ilja is using some others that actually goes beyond all these steps. I should show a file.
thing is here what is changing. You can present some nice graphs and some nice reports. It's usually much nicer if you give some possibility to operational managers, to strategic managers, to play a little bit themselves with the data and do some selections and filters and comparisons, and then you can, yeah, then you can really empower end users. And it's a part of philosophy in the world of click and click sense. They call it self-service analytics, kind of. You give some basic things, you set up something from an IT part, so, and then you let marketeers playing themselves.
Here are some of our activities, and we have response percent and average gift and total amount. And then you can change the parameters. You can say, oh, I only want to check those that have more than 1,000 recipients. And I can say, oh, I only want those that go by mail. And only for and then the decision makers can actually sit and analyze and try to know your data. So it's there are several tools and it's all about how do you find this process from the data input to making decisions? How does that fit in your organization? And how could you do that? And this is democratizing your data. So this is also a very good way to do it.
So are there any questions, reflections? Yeah?
Does it work? Does your board have a go? Do they dig in?
No.
Well, it's a little bit double. In some sense, what I started to see with board members, usually it depends on your board composition, but usually you have one board member who's really a little bit more interested and digs in. And the other thing, if you build this kind of interactive data exploration dashboard stuff and you show them what you can do, and that's again the psychology of building trust, you are showing them that they are really following into data and that you can analyze it, and it gives them trust. If they don't see that you are able to do it, they think you are working blind, and that's another element. So even if they don't look at it, show them, show them that they can play. And I just, it's a kind of more communications thing. I tend to communicate regularly that I have a new dashboard thing that they can install on their computer and play with it themselves. I know they don't do it, but I just keep communicating that it's available now, and it's trust building, basically. It's just by.
But of course, some of my staff colleagues will do it and make decisions based on it.
Yeah, that's indeed, that's the other thing. There's just one graph for the dashboard for the face-to-face officer. All those codes are individual recruiters. So we have average gifts, median gifts, and whatsoever. And you see that those kind of people, yes, really know, dive into it and play with it and see, oh, I found out this and I found out this. And then they come back and I was thinking about this and this. Could you add some more visualization showing this? And then you start up to have an interaction. And they do use it, the more operational, well, strategic operational program, fundraising program managers, they do use it. There's a last slide. Yeah? There's actually not a last slide. There's another one. Okay. So this is a quote you know. Yeah. So fundraising 90% heart and 10% skills. We made a little bit adaption on it. That's the following. So, any more questions? Reflections? Okay. So the last session of CiviCRM. Have fun and a safe trip back.